Well, friends, welcome to our first activity for us in New York from the Theosophical Society Point Loma Blavatsky House. So we're really looking forward to build up an experience in a very big international city. We have a program today, what is a combination of lectures and workshops. The workshops is a very important part to us because there we like to exercise with each other what you have learned from the lecture. The lecture gives you the opportunity afterwards for a couple of questions before we start on the workshop, so that, let's say, the whole process and the things we have to do is clear. First, we will start with a small introduction of Theosophy, pure and simple. There was a lot of discussion about the use of the word simple. So we have not the intention to simplify it. We have the intention to make it very clear to you. So don't hesitate if we are not clear enough. Raise your hand and ask your question. So what I will do now, I will give you a very short overview what it means, Theosophy, pure and simple. Seeing all the faces, I think that most of the people know already what Theosophy is, but although I think for our new friends we have to go through all these steps. So, what is Theosophy? Who are we? Theosophy is the name coming from Theos and Sophia, meaning divine wisdom or very wisdom of the gods. And the idea is that we understand from this that it is a very universal wisdom, not something special, not owned by some persons or organizations, but a very universal wisdom running over, we call that, million and millions of years, and can be found on many and many places. But you have to do some effort. You have to investigate and study a bit here and there. We can say the latest incarnation, as I like to call that, is from 1875, presented by Helena Petrovna Blavatsky. And she was, how you say, giving a new impulse, a new enlightenment of that very old general Asian wisdom. What we like to emphasize with you is Theosophy is for all a very practical philosophy. What we like to say with this is that if you study Theosophy and you can do it 24/7, but you don't apply it in your daily life, it becomes a type of academic knowledge. So we try to make clear today and to exercise with you that how do we practice it? What is the consequences of the teachings you will hear today, received, and what can it mean for all your daily questions and all your things you run in from your job, your relations, and life or few medical questions, and so on. From our tradition, there was a very practical implication of Theosophy in the period that we are having the Raja Yoga School in Point Loma in San Diego from 1899 till 1942. And that was a full, let's say, community with universities, schools, and so on. And there was Theosophy really something in practical life. That means in the morning teaching for the children and study, and in the afternoon working in gardens and all type of other jobs and performing plays, etc., etc. So nowadays we are quite different because we don't have that location anymore, and our main activity is in the Netherlands, and I'd like to show you a small overview for 4 minutes to give you a little bit of an impression.
Maar wat doen ze nou? Ze liggen op hun plank in het water en wachten of peddelen.
Goed, dames en heren, gezien de tijd. Maar ik stel wat vragen.
Niets is minder. Onze lager merkt dat de leiding. Nee, je gaat tegen de ook de macht om bewakers.
Ja? Thanks.
Thank you for your intention. It is very good to say that this was an impression made a while ago. And between then and now, we have intensified our relation with the Swedish and German section very much. We embrace each other very well. And we try to set up this type of activity also in Sweden now and in German. And we have very good expectations from that and a very good cooperation. Okay, dit is a little bit of an intention, or sorry, impression from what we're doing and how we are doing this. You have seen one thing, modern technique we like very much, because it gives us a lovely opportunity, and you can also say in a certain way, it is the modern language. Skype is impossible to take away nowadays, or other techniques like this, and so on. So, internet is something what is very hard to live without, etc. So now we like to start to our seven jewels story for today. And we found that very important and very fundamental to speak with each other about the seven jewels. Because if you look around in daily life and you don't know about theosophy, and you observed and you see how things are going in life and in physics and in the universe, and you are do a little bit of observation, you will see that there is a type of fundamental repetition in the way things behave and work. That is something what you can call a universal wisdom. And it is very good to investigate how is that wisdom looking like and how is that expressed. And what we have tried to do in this graphic presentation is to give you a view about it. If you look, for instance, what we have done on the top is putting three types of lights, and what we try to say is that lights represent the three fundamental propositions of the secret doctrine, in short, very short. And if they project their forces or their wisdom or their effects into the outer world, it gives you a very lovely seven basic fundamental ideas. So what you can say, this is the abstraction and can be hard to understand, but in daily life you find it back in this seven fundamental wisdoms. And from here we like then to start a little bit about them. If you look to the secret doctrine and you look into the propositions, of course you find them very extensive described. But if you have to get it in one word, we say boundlessness. Infinite, you can say as well, if you want to use a more technical word. Yeah. If you go over to the other one, what is also a fundamental idea, you find cyclic motion. So that means that wherever you look in manifestation, you will find back the cyclic processes. You can think about the high and the low water. You can think about day and night, the year. So there are many and many very good examples from this behavior in nature, a very fundamental behavior. And also human beings are no exception of it. Another one, very important, is the third one, what you can describe as above, as below, so below. That is a very fundamental idea, because that expressed that how it is on higher spiritual level, the processes are the same on the lower level. So, let's say, in principle, the same processes work through all the different levels. The way it looks like can be slightly different, or maybe looks different to us, because we have not the right consciousness for that particular level. So that is another very important element. So if you present them together, that three, we should realize that it is an hypothesis. You will never find in theosophy that you have to believe this, or that you should accept this, or and so on, and so on. It is not what the church is doing, and so on. It is just hypothesis. And what is the idea of a hypothesis? Is that it gives you a certain amount of responsibility for yourself, that you cannot accept it. I say, okay, sounds good. I will accept that three basic ideas. Because you have to realize one thing. If you look in daily life and you ask yourself very honest, how many things do I believe and how many things I have experienced myself as be true? Then I think if I am very optimistic, I have to say for myself, 80% we believe and 20% we have experienced ourselves. I will give you an example. If you look in the newspaper and you find a new description or a different view on Einstein's fundamental relativity, then, and it sounds good and the article is well written, you go over it and you think, can be true. But you have to believe one thing, or you have to realize one thing, you believe it on that particular moment. Making it true for yourself is that you have to go through that same mental exercise and experience in your daily life, in your daily situations, that that same fundamental law is working out exactly the same. And that takes time. That is not something what you can do very easily. So what you have to realize that if you make study of theosophy, your responsibility is laying in the fact that you can accept the basic idea as a hypothesis and say for yourself, okay, as long as I am able to experience the same fundamental ideas in life, for me it is true. Consequences from this point of view is that we all, as human beings, having our own experience, our own way of looking into the world, so we build, in principle, also our own truth. And we have to realize, if we start to have communication with each other, and we like to exchange experience, we should realize very well that my experience is not equal your experience, and by exchanging what we have experienced in daily life, we can help each other to find that same fundamental truth in daily activities and so on. So, from this very simple reason, we see that these three conditions and the seven jewels of wisdom are just a matter of finding yourself and investigating yourself, how you build it up and how you can experience the truth of it. A very important consequence of this tree is what we called the spiritual point of view. Spirit, life, consciousness, you can say that is the force behind matter. But spirit, force, matter are just the same in different states of the same being. What will it say? You can say, what to us is spirit, because we are not able to see it, that is a higher force. And the things what we are able to see in the manifestation, you can say that is matter, but we should realize that it is matter to us. For being is a much lower level of manifestation, what we called force is to them this spirit. It is all relative. So that is a very important thing. On the other hand, we should realize that all things what are not visible are not by definition spiritual, because it is also possible that we see material things from a very low and coarse state of being, that it is even out of our view. So the very simple rule, all invisible things are spiritual, is thus not true. It is like the daylight we see. We can see up to a certain short wavelength, the ultraviolet, or we can see up to a certain long wavelength, the infrared. But beyond that and below that, that are the areas that are invisible to us, but still they exist. Yeah? So that is a very important point. So from theosophical point of view, we should realize that behind the matter and the outer manifestation we see, there is always a force active. And that is a very fundamental thing what we should embrace, because if you speak about reincarnation, and you only accept that the material world is a fact to you, what should be incarnated then the next time? What should be left after your cremation or whatever? Yeah? There is nothing. So if you want to accept the ideas of the seven jewels, you should realize that we speak about the characteristic of the spiritual being, not the body. The body is just an expression of the spiritual being. To maintain, to feed, etc., etc. We need it for building up experience. We need it for communication. But it is an instrument. It is not a goal in itself. Another important idea is that we should realize that if we start to study the seven jewels of wisdom much more in detail, that we should use the three propositions as a touchstone, as a proof. And in our handout, you will see that we have tried to make a very nice table for you, the relations between the three fundamental propositions and the outcome of the seven jewels. But what we like to say with this statement is that if you go in daily life and you come to the conclusion, for instance, that things can be lost forever, then you should realize that it is not in line with the first proposition of the secret doctrine. Boundlessness, infinite, means everything is there, everything was there, and everything will be there. So, new inventions don't exist. There are only discoveries, because the fundamental possibility was there. We were always there. We will be always there. Not in the same expression, not in the same type of manifestation, not in the same level of experience, but you have to realize that this is the way of touching the elements. Yeah? And if you come to the conclusion by studying the seven jewels, this is all much too complicated to me, I don't have this opportunity, or I have don't this knowledge, or I'm missing this, and so on, please realize that from the first proposition, we say you have everything in you already. Nobody has to give it to you. The only thing what you have to do is to learn to express it. Don't worry, you have an infinite amount of time available to do that. So there is no rush in it to express it. It was for our group a very nice exercise to investigate more, a little bit more, than just theosophical literature, where these seven jewels are coming from. And that is, it was a very good exercise. We say, of course, they come from the Theosophia, the very fundamental wisdom of the gods. That are seven fundamental ideas, and we should be able to find them on much more places. So we did it, and we found them of quite some considerable amount of places. But the most important thing, and that is what we like to exercise with you as well today, is that you have to exercise them in combination with each other. Try to explain reincarnation to your neighbor without making use of karma. It is almost impossible. Try to explain what the effect will be from building up experience in the next incarnation. If you don't want to use to accept the idea of hierarchies, you cannot explain it. Grow and building up experience and start from the point where you was ending last incarnation and so on can only be explained if you use the seven jewels in combination with the seven jewels. We did this same exercise in San Diego, and people say, this is difficult. And if you ask them, explain to me what is the usual reincarnation, without realizing, they start to use the other seven fundamentals, seven jewels as well. And so what we like to do today is to go over them in a certain combination and give us the experience of going in detail and look with each other what they will bring if you combine them. Another thing is that we try to say is that the answer of all big questions in life can be found by applying the 7x7 rules. So, if you have a life experience, if you ask yourself, what is the use for doing this and this in this incarnation, try to project it in a bigger point of view and ask yourself, what will be the use of this experience, of this action, for the next incarnation? For me, there is always a very simple answer on that. I say, everything what you can take with you in next life is useful. Yeah? And then you can easily check it off if you like to have that new car or not, yeah? And put all the effort in it. So, to look in our literature and to find some indications about the seven basic doctrines, we found a very good expression from Dr. De Brugge in the Fundamentals of the Esoteric Philosophy, where he will say, okay, the seven keys of wisdom are very important and give you a much deeper view. So, and you find it on more places. But you find it on not so much places, the recommendations to start to use them very close in relation with each other. If you go over the seven jewels, you will see that, of course, the first one, as an example, we know that very well as rebirth, re-embodiment, reincarnation. But in principle, it is the very first expression, the most fundamental expression of the second proposition, the cyclic recurrences. So that is the very general idea. So it is not only applying for human being or animals and so on. Every conscious being has to go through this process of cycle. Karma, one of the most, discussed duels. We really experience, at least in Europe, that people only speak in karma most of the time in negative sense. If they experience something what is negative to them, they speak about karma. If they are very lucky in the lottery or something like that and they have cash 2 million, then they call it luck and they don't call it karma. So that is one of the things. But we try to emphasize there is no good or bad karma. There is only consequence on your action. So you should realize that it is a very neutral situation. And some things we called today negative can work out or experience later on, looking backwards, as a very positive experience where we have learned a lot from that particular situation. And then we have the two theosophical or two Sanskrit terms, the lokas and the talas, the hierarchies and hierarchical structures, also a very fundamental idea. It is not only running in the fire brigade or in the army or whatever systems what express themselves very well. It is running in daily life very actual. And the only thing what you should realize that you can make a level of hierarchies, or you can justify it in a hierarchy based on, for instance, financial position, which is very popular nowadays, or social position, or spiritual position, or having wisdom, and so on, and so on. So there are many point of views, but we will all see that there are different level active all over. Swabhava, a very important one, for some people very hard to understand, but it says in very simple idea that we start from the point for the point where we stopped last time. So we are not coming as a blank sheet, we are coming with our history, with our karmic things we have built up in many lives before, and from there on we start. It's very good for parents to know that they don't have the full responsibility from what they get at home, because they're bringing in their own problems and their own possibilities and opportunities, etc., etc. And we have to deal with each other, and we have to help each other to go on from the point where we stopped last time and give it an, let's say, constructive and positive direction. On the other hand, people think that Swabhava is something that is very fixed. But we try to say, no, it is not fixed. It is, how do you say that? It can be grow, you can develop it. But for some people it goes very slow, for other people it goes faster. And if it is goes slow, you may have the impression that it is fixed, but principle, it is not possible. Evolution, involution. Also a difficult thing, but very important to realize that evolution means we bring things out. And involution means that we, let's say, retracted more to the inner level, that we stopped expressing some things. And you see that evolution and involution is always going together. And during the life, we find many different stages in that, that you can see that we expressed some characteristics when we are young and so on, and when we become older, they go to the background and other characteristics are coming to the foreground. So each life faces have its own opportunities and challenges. Six, for a lot of people, and quite difficult subjects. The two parts of evolution. For the ITC days, unity is a basic idea, but we will run over it, but I'd like to say a few words. Because if you go from the first proposition of the secret doctrine, the boundlessness, the infinite, so from there you can easily conclude that everything is related with everything. And if you start thinking about that, and you combine that with the first, with the second one, with karma, you can realize that it is like as the ocean. The same moment you put your feet in the ocean, you have an impact on the ocean. Of course, you can ask yourself, what is the effect from doing this? On the other shore, for instance, from here to Japan or whatever, in principle, there is an effect. You are not able to say there is no effect at all. Maybe it is small. Maybe it is very hard to measure and so on, but there will be a principal effect. So from that point of view, we should realize that if we developed ourselves, that we immediately run in the very fundamental question of compassion. If we develop, who will be the prophet? Who will have the profit from it? We alone, or do we share? Or do we only develop by helping each other, and development is just a consequence instead of something what we like to aim and to go for. And seven, one of the most deepest and mystic from the seven jewels, that is the totality, het understand of the whole system as one living, big organism, one very big being, where we play our part in it. It is good, maybe it is good for you to see that on the moment we start to investigate and see why were we able to find the seven jewels, or at least a part of it, you can say, okay, theosophy, very obvious. Hinduism, yes, of course. Bhagavad Gita, no problem at all, as an expression of Hinduism. Buddhism, no problem. Taoism, Tao Te King, everywhere. Judaism, Christianity, Islam, no problem. Plato, Eddas, no problem. So what you can prove, in fact, with this investigation, that it is indeed a very universal way of teaching, and a very fundamental principle what you are easily to recognize all over. Oh yes, Popovu is missing on this list, but that is one of the later discoveries we have done. We have to make our second English Lucifer based on a number of articles around the seven jewels. So if you later on want to reread what we have presented today, you can have it in PDF by the internet. You can have it in print. We have it with us. We have the handouts. It's maybe very well to consider the expression of Blavatsky, found to be back in the collected writings number 8 on the moment. Yeah. Where he speaks about the seven mysteries of wisdom. So I think there he emphasized the importance of studying them. There's another expression from her: seven keys which belong to and open each one of these inmost sevenfold mysteries. And then she makes a small remark saying that the last two are very, spiritual and very from the deeper meaning level to be studied. And we end with the presentation from a quotation from Dr. De Brugge in Studies in Occult Philosophy, that is also a nice, important remark that we should realize that it is, we use them as keywords, and reincarnation as the first jewel is a very good example. We always think about reincarnation, but we should realize that it is cycle recurrences, and it is only in a human situation be called reincarnation, but it is a fundamental principle what you can find on the different terms. So what he called then keywords, catchwords, reminding terms. Okay, this is the first 7x7 introduction. If this raises some questions, please feel free. I will try to answer.
When you listed where theosophy is found, you know, the different religions and philosophies, I'm not familiar with that last listing. Adas, I think it said? Edas, thank you. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Can you repeat the question that it was? Edas. That is the, a European known source of wisdom that is typical what we can see in the Scandinavian countries. Norway, Sweden, Finland, Denmark, that part. They are, of course, not standing on their own. They found their roots in the more general traditions in Europe, but you can say it is a very typical and well-preserved tradition in that part. The Icelandic traditions is also much connected with that. And what you will see is that if you combine the stories in the Eddas with, for instance, the Greek myths, you see a lot of similarities in it. So, of course, more traditions, so the Eddas, and I mentioned already the Popovu. But what we like to say with this is that we can realize that all over the world, all that old traditions are more or less, let's say, reincarnations of the universal wisdom, getting terms and phrases related to that particular period and cult. Yeah. For instance, if you compare the Greek with the Egyptian one, you find a lot of similarity in it, but it is not one-to-one. As we use nowadays theosophy, if we compare theosophy 1875 with now, this, let's say 2013, we see that the principle is the same, but the terms we use and the examples we give and the phrases we use are also changed and more adapted to our time. Yeah, from our experience, it is even needed. And if you go in Europe around and you use all the old terms and old phrases, and you are not flexible in translating the basic principle to the modern way of thinking, you have a misconnection on that particular moment, especially with young people. Yeah. So the challenge there is that we have to use modern phrases, but still maintain the principles in it. Yeah. And it can be a challenge. And we approach that challenge most of the time by working in small groups together and helping each other to preparing lectures and seminars and articles and so on and so on. Yeah. Good. Other questions? Okay. If not, then we start to listen to reincarnation and karma and hierarchies as the first sets of jewels presented by Henk Bezemer. Thank you.